Done this one here. And what the museum is trying to achieve in this graphic is to give you an idea of stores and spears and all sorts of things you need to take. But I'm deliberately striking it from in for me because a lot of people ask me, what's this about parcels and mail? I don't know if they were Titanic's full name, it's RMS Titanic. And RMS stands for Royal Mail Ship and Royal Mail Steam. And that meant that it's a white star line. As a former ship owner myself, when you get to building ships, you obviously look at the industry, really important the ship you build. And with Titanic, there were two main areas where Titanic actually made money. One, beginning. The being third class passengers. Not second class passengers, and first class, that's icing on the cake. Third class passengers was a huge role in the industry, and mail was a huge role in the industry. Give you a modern day example, because it's still different from 1912. If you have a jumbo jet, if you just fill it up every time you get first class passengers and second class passengers, and then you'll take passengers elsewhere, that plane will take off a number of times because it will go back. You need everyone in the back, myself, the ones after the chin, and the family. That's where you get the money, not the first class. Titanic is absolutely different. Now, when Titanic struck the iceberg, I'm trying to imagine Ryan, but it struck the ship here, beneath the waterline, which is struck in the mail room. Now, on board Titanic, there were five postal workers, on board Titanic. Three from the US Postal Service, and two from the British Royal Mail. And those five postmen were charged with going through over 3,000 mail bags between Southampton and New York. So when the ship went to New York, all working post office would not be flooded with all these mail bags. However, we believe that the first victims of the disaster were here. I think at least three of the postal workers tried to get the mail. So when it struck at number 14, on the mail there, the postal workers were missing the ship in the cabin. And you had to come down here and try and lift out as much as the mailbags as possible. That's because these mailbags are full of volumes. Simmons like myself, who's over the years about all of these sections of the sea one thing I want to point out to move on here. This area of the ship was reinforced. It's a long old ship. This area of Titanic was actually reinforced. We'll be talking about icebergs soon. Bear that in mind. looking across here. You look at this glass case here. Now, it's all by the museum. This holds to Captain Smith, the master of the Titanic. And it didn't have to look at the Titanic, it didn't have to look at it. This is solid in its case, and it's in his home. And even if he did it 2 years later, Captain Smith lived, he survived. There's every chance he would call not for active service troops. This is all the neighbors left behind. He would have taken the solid from the dress rehearsals of the police. This solid here, this casing, has been in the possession of the city of St. Louis. It's given to the museum about a week or two after the disaster. Captain Smith was able to present it to the city. And that big dog you see here, clearly that dog is just called Captain Smith. But one time he didn't take a dog with him, it was in the Titanic. And incredibly, one of the dogs in the house, the major two dogs survived. One of the little dogs carried by American aviation ship, which actually had to come from their arms. Another dog, similar to that dog, leaving that, swam in the sea for 7 hours alongside a lifeboat until the captain came. That had to be generally accepted back in 1912. Anywhere in the world, in November, could any hotel match the first class facilities on the Royal Titanic and the first class restaurants. So instead of having a photograph on the postcard, for example, if you have a first class order in that, you get 12 of those. That tastes the menu. I'm going to show you a plate that's actually from Titanic, not from the bottom of the North Atlantic. I'll actually explain the story behind it in a minute. Okay, if you look in here, you'll see a plate from Titanic. Now this plate, even despite the crack in it, is actually worth getting a lot of money, apparently. And there's a story behind this plate. There's history about it as well. This plate here was made by a company called Royal Crown Derby. Now what's fascinating about this particular plate, this pattern, is that these people only made this plate for two other locations. Back in 1912. And those two other locations were Buckingham Palace and Windsor Castle. These people only made this plate for royalty. And they were so impressed by the specification of Titanic, the type of passengers it would have on board, the richest people in the world, like John Jacob Astor IV, he was the world's richest man, so he was on board Titanic, that they wanted to be associated with Titanic. Now, this plate here, as I say, it's from Titanic, not from the bottom of the sea. There's a story behind it, I'll tell you. Online, if you like. This plate here was taken off the Titanic by a stewardess. When the Olympic and Titanic were together in Belfast, I think it was getting repaired after colliding with the British warship. A stewardess was walking through the first class restaurant in the Titanic. Walked past the table and she did that. She put that plate in her blouse, walked off the ship with it, walked across the Olympic, and gave it to a friend on the Olympic. And a friend on the Olympic kept it. She said, "I want you to have this plate, only royalty eats off this plate." And for reasons which I don't know on, how they found it, eventually found its way into the museums of Southampton, and it's here today. So that plate was physically on Titanic, that was taken off by a stewardess who would have been shot at dawn if she had caught her taking that off the ship. Okay. It nearly did. They needed 6,500 tons and they just made it. Great shame, because if they hadn't got it, the ship would have sailed. And this is the third deformity. It's called the New York Incident. And we have photographs of it taken by an Irish photographer who left the ship in Ireland, the last port of call before a fateful collision with the iceberg. So I'm going to start this photograph here quickly. This is Titanic you're looking at. This is Southampton, obviously. She's just come out of the dock here. The passengers have just embarked, so she's come out. Turn left into Southampton water. Here's the New York. She's tied up.
Picture number two.
She's well out of water, so we know that. Because she has a really cold, it's a cold strike. So here you have the world's largest man-made moving object at 46,000 tons. When she's actually moving through the water, she's displacing more than 46,000 tons, probably in excess of over 50,000 tons of water. That, pushing that 50,000 tons out of the water, she's very close to the rock. And the force of the water coming across here, snaps on the water and lightens the wave. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.